There was a person who came late for the transport from the city. Well, I thank the organizer for inviting me to give a lecture. So there will be a brief presentation of several problems which were of my interest in the past. It is not a presentation which is specially prepared for this Balkan Olympiad, but it is a collection of some previous presentations. Well, this is the content. I will tell a little bit about the Ising model, also a little about differential equations, the Kuramoto model, stability, deterministic chaos, most beyond monitoring, and about the Olympiads and some other related results. So the Ising model is a model which is very it is very present in the publications. Well, you can see at the bottom, according to Google Scholar, in the previous year, there were more than 13,000 papers published in the world. The model was, at the beginning, intended to describe the phenomena of magnetization, in particular, the transition from a magnetic state to non-magnetic state. Well, here the model is presented in two-dimensional variant. So the points on the left represent some particles, let's say spins, which can be oriented in two possible orientations, up and down. And in this lattice, which is pentagonal, a little bit more complex than some simpler lattices like square lattice or triangular lattice, it is a two-dimensional problem. The spins interact between their neighbors. There is some energy for the interaction between two neighbors. On the right-hand side, you can see that, for example, spins indicated by D and S2 interact with the interaction with strength J. The equation, the expression for H is, well, the energy of the interaction between the spins in the elementary cell of the lattice. The model was proposed in previous century, almost 100 years exactly ago. It was solved for the one-dimensional problem by Ising 5 years later. For two dimensions, the problem was solved in 1944 by Onsager. Here they are. The solution in two dimensions was very complex, and after so many years, some simplified versions have been found, but they are still rather complex. And for example, if you want to present this, one full lecture is a minimum. What the model has shown in two dimensions, it has shown that there is transition at some particular critical point for the temperature, which divides the ferromagnetic state when the spins are ordered, all have some preferential orientation, and a state when they are distributed randomly in both directions. Well, this is a result which is obtained by so-called mean field approximation. It is supposed that in the lattice there is some average magnetic field which is created by the orientation of the spins. So one can imagine that each spin is in some average field which is produced, which is made by the other spins. And by M, one one considers the magnetization of the lattice, the average orientation of the of an arbitrary spin. This is the equation which describes the phenomenon within this approximation, and the solution is graphically presented. There is some critical temperature. Above this critical temperature, the solution is equal to zero. Below, there is non-zero value. What of interest is to find the so-called critical exponents, which describe the behavior of the magnetization close to the critical point. In this particular case, for this approximative solution, the behavior is like square root. Well, that's why the exponent is equal to 1/2. Well, some different ways to solve the Ising model is by the method of Monte Carlo. The method Monte Carlo suggests that there is some randomness, and following some method, we could obtain the result, some approximation for the problem. Well, first of all, before discussing again the Ising model, here is a picture of the Comte de Buffon, who proposed a problem long ago, which is named after him, Buffon problem. He is otherwise famous for the study of nature, and he published nearly 40 volumes of books studying minerals and animals in France. Well, the problem, you see, matches which are distributed without any rule, there are some parallel lines. In this particular case, the length of the matches is the same as the distance between the parallel lines. And imagine well, such a situation that you throw randomly the matches to the plane, and the question is how frequently they will cross some of the lines. And the answer, which could be obtained analytically, is 2 over pi. And by doing such experiments, well, that's what it is, the Monte Carlo method, you could get an approximation for the number of pi. Well, applied to the Ising model for the square lattice, what is done is to flip arbitrary spins one by one, to flip them from their orientation to the opposite orientation. If in this step you obtain a lower energy for this particular spin, then you continue with this new orientation. If the energy becomes larger, then you have to decide again by selecting some random number and comparing this with the Boltzmann factor, which describes the equilibrium of such a system. And by doing this process repeatedly, you will obtain the dependence of the magnetization on the temperature. And it is shown here for several values of the temperatures what is obtained. At low temperatures, close to the epsilon axis, the magnetization is close to 1, so most of the spins are oriented in the same direction. When the temperature is increased, the magnetization decreases, and well, apparently there is some transition when the decline of the magnetization is rather large. Well, it is difficult to detect this critical point by Monte Carlo method, but it is not impossible by doing this random process, this Monte Carlo simulation for a sufficiently long time. Well, this method is applied, for example, to do the calculations in three-dimensional problem, which is not solved exactly, and which is thought that it is unsolvable. Here, there is something similar, but in a different field and different situation, but there are similarities. So this is a text from a book published in the beginning of 18th century, and well, I have seen it in a book by Bykovsky and other authors published in 2001. Well, some explorers of the Far East, in Thailand in particular, they observed such a phenomenon that, well, in twilight, fireflies, which emit some light, they have a bioluminescence property, and they do this simultaneously. Well, this is illustrated. Well, you see on a tree many fireflies, and they are all alight in a particular moment. But what happens is, well, this. The somehow they manage to do this simultaneously. They are somehow synchronized. They twinkle at the same time all together. Well, to explain this phenomena, we need a brief introduction to differential equations. You are going to hear more about them later on. I didn't realize that such is the program beforehand. So, for example, how we define the velocity of a particle. We consider what is the displacement for a particle for some short time. We could divide the time with sequences which are have notation t with some index. So for some time t I plus 1 minus t I, we measure the distance which is traveled by the particle, and we take the ratio. This is an approximate expression for the velocity. If the time interval is smaller, the expression would be more precise. So to have exact expression, we have to take the limit when the time interval goes to zero. Well, this is what is called derivative. Perhaps you are all familiar with this, but perhaps there are some who do not know this notion. So the derivative, the notation of derivative, when it is with respect to time, it is a dot above the letter. But it is not quite visible, but I couldn't do it better. So if we take this limit and we have a derivative, in the second line, we have an example of a first order differential equation. First order because the derivative is of the first order. On the right hand side, we have some given function. Well, so if this given function is known, for example, by measurements, if we measure how the velocity evolves, so we know this function f of t, then the first line can be rearranged in the expression given in the third line. So knowing how f changes with time, we could express the position of the particle at instant I plus 1, knowing its position in some previous instant and the velocity for this interval. As some approximate solution of the equation would be an expression like this. This is known as Euler approximation for solving differential equations. Well, some equations could be solved analytically, but some have to be solved only by numerical means. This is the simplest method. There are much more sophisticated methods which give very good results, which is evidenced by many examples. For example, connection between satellites in the space. To control all this, you have to know really how the motion happens. In the last line, there is a more general example of first order differential equations. On the right hand side, the function which is given is dependent on x, the unknown function, and time. So solving the equations, it means finding how x depends on t. Well, you have already met some differential equations, but perhaps it wasn't said. The second Newton law is a differential equation of second order, because we have an equality between a product of mass and acceleration equal to the force. Acceleration is derivative, first derivative of velocity, and velocity is derivative of the path of the position of the particle. So we have second derivative. In the Newton equation is a differential equation of second order. Well, if we have a motion in one direction, then there is one variable to be found. But if the motion happens in three-dimensional space, we need three coordinates to describe the motion. So actually, we will have a system of three differential equations. Here, the first line is a differential equation, let's say, for particle I. The particles, they move along a circle. So their position is described by an angle. The angle is theta. And the differential equation for theta is given in the first line. Omega I, it is the frequency with which the particle rotates along the circle. So here we have a system of n ordinary differential equation of first order. N is an arbitrary model. Well, this is something which is known as Kuramoto model. It is a simplification of oscillatory motion. If you follow a particle, the projection of a particle on the x-axis, well, it goes forward and backward. It oscillates. So it is system of oscillators. And by the Kuramoto model, besides the particular frequency for each oscillator, there is some interaction between different oscillators. This interaction is described by the sum and by the function sine of the difference between the angles of two oscillators. Well, in nature, there are many examples of oscillators. You have seen the fireflies, but also, for example, in the human body, the oscillations of the cells in the brain, the oscillations of the heart, the oscillations of blood pressure, and well, many others example could be given. So Kuramoto managed to solve this problem in 75 by introducing in the second line such a substitution in the equations. So the equations are somehow separated, but not fully, because in the third line, the parameter r and psi from the second line connect all the coordinates of all the oscillators. Parameter r, similar to the parameter m in the case of Ising model, the magnetization, here R is the order parameter. Well, the equation has been solved. The number of publications documented in Google Scholar for the previous year is more than 4,000. Well, depending on the values of the parameters, you could have situations which are described by this slide. On the left, R is close to 1. On the right, it is close to 0. In the first case, the oscillators somehow move all together, or nearly. And on the other case, when R is close to 0, they move independently, so they are well, randomly distributed and approximately uniformly. Well, this is the solution. So we have a similar curve to the solution given in the mean field approximation previously for the Ising model. Again, the dependence of R is like square root, and actually exactly square root given at the bottom for the particular distribution of the oscillators among the various frequency, which is given to the left. G of the of omega is Lorentzian function. So for some interval, you see the equation at the top. R appears at both sides. It could be cancelled. So one solution of the equation is R equals 0, which is at the beginning when the k is small. But then this solution, which is still a solution, R equals 0, becomes unstable. And the stable solution is given by the parabolic curve. About the stability which was mentioned. Well, Ruđer Bošković was a scientist from Dubrovnik. He published a book, well, at the time when Buffon was living. And he imagined that the interaction between two atoms, he was speaking about atoms, the idea which was pronounced much earlier by Democritus. And he imagined that the force between two atoms at some distance r is given by this oscillating curve. Well, actually, this was only guessing. There were no known experimental results at the time for something like this. And actually, such a curve is not very common, but it appears for the interaction of ions in liquid metals. This has been experimentally verified in the last century. Normally, nowadays, one would plot the potential. Here, Ruđer Bošković has made a plot of force depending on the distance between the atoms. Now, let's consider some particular position. Let's say the position on the x-axis L. What is characteristic of this point? Imagine that the particle, the particles are a little bit to the left from this point, so the distance is smaller. Then the force is positive, and it will push the particle toward right, that is toward the point L. If the particle is a little bit further away, to the right of L, the force is negative, and it will push the particle back to the point L. So this point is stable. If there is some fluctuation from this point and the point moves to the left or right, the forces control this situation and push the particle back. The same consideration for another point, the point L, shows that if there is such a fluctuation from this point, that this point is unstable and the particle would move further away toward some stable particle. So this is an illustration of the notion of stability of some position. Well, here this is illustrated with a graph of a parabolic function. So we have a series of points which are generated by some given function. In this case, a parabolic function. Well, it is not quite visible. There is a green line on the left side. When we do these iterations with a parameter a equal to 0.5, we iterate the first equation in the second line. And if we start from some arbitrary point, actually, well, the black point, and do these iterations, actually, we will move closer and closer to the interaction, to the intersection of the red and blue curves. This is a stable point. In the other case, if a equal is a, if a is equal to 1, the intersection is unstable, and this green line trajectory will move away from the intersection. Well, the stability condition is given in the third line. The derivative at the fixed point should be by modulus less than 1. Fixed point is the point in which, if we start from that fixed point, we will remain in the fixed point by these iterations. Well, problems in this field have been discussed at the beginning of last century by a French mathematician, Poincaré, but they obtained an impetus about 1975 by discovering some properties of such one-dimensional maps. Well, here it is shown that on the left side, for a particular value of A, there is a periodic trajectory of 3 points. Here, by trajectory, I mean a sequence of 3 points which repeat infinitely. We start from one, go to the second point, to the third, and then next step returns us back to the initial point, and it continues like that. Well, if we here, this logistic map is given in two different forms, which are equivalent. You could make a transformation from one to another. So at the right-hand side, the graph shows what happens with such iterations when varying the parameter r. At the beginning, there is one fixed point. Then it becomes unstable, and there are two fixed points. And later on, they become unstable themselves. So there are four fixed points. It has a period of 4 points become stable, and so on. And there are some regularities here which are amazing and which do not depend on the particular function with which you make the iteration. If you make the iterations, let's say, with function sine or function which is quadratic part and something else, let's say a quartic term, well, in principle, you will get the same picture. Well, the question of stability was discussed by Lyapunov, and well, I could briefly say that if the distance from a particular point over time could be made less than arbitrary epsilon, if we manage to find such a delta that the initial conditions are within the bounds there in the second line, then this means that the particular point is stable. Well, here is the example of a Lorentz system. There are 3 differential equations, and the original equations are given in black. On the green function is added, and it will be explained in the next slide. The motion in three-dimensional space, so the coordinates x, y, and z of this system of equations, which are solved numerically. It's impossible to solve them analytically. Well, the motion is described by the picture at the bottom. There are three fixed points in this system. You see, if we take x equals 0, y equals 0, z equals 0, the right-hand side without this added green function, the right-hand side of the system is 0. So all x, y, and z remain constant. And there are two additional fixed points which can be found by solving three nonlinear equations, algebraic equations, for the coordinates of these fixed points. They are given as c plus minus. Now, if at the bottom is the graph motion of the particle if f of t is 0. If f of t is not 0, and we want to make some of the fixed points, which are all unstable, to make them stable, we could add this function which was given in green color, like the first line there. This was proposed by Piragas, and it is an example of non-invasive control. The paper has more than 4,000 citations. You see, the function f has some parameter k, and the difference of the value of the functions y at two different instances, t and t minus capital T. And there are some different variations of this feedback proposed by Piragas. In the next slide, what is proposed is to use a feedback with delay which is not constant as in the previous case. In the previous case, T capital is constant. Here, it is some function. The function selected is given by the three expressions at the bottom. Sawtooth function, a random function, and sine wave. And this is what is obtained in the case of equations for the Lorentz model. On the left side, in the vertical column, some coordinate is represented of the motion. I can see from here. It is coordinate x. And on the right-hand side, it is shown this additional term which was added by Piragas as a function of time. On the right-hand side, we see that up to the instant 300 on the time axis, there is no feedback from outside. So the motion on the left is appearing like random, without regularity. When after the instant 300, the control is introduced, at the beginning, the control also oscillates randomly. The motion is also random, but at some instant, already the motion becomes stationary. The fixed point has been reached, and on the right-hand side, after that instant, also the feedback is equal to zero. That's why it is said that the feedback is non-invasive. For a while, it is invasive, but then, once stability is reached, it is non-invasive. Well, the method is actually applied in some medical disorders like Parkinson's disease, and I have seen demonstrations like this in conferences when it is visible that there is improvement in the health of the patients. Here horizontally, what is shown, the graphs on the left and on the right, are for the different types of delay of the time according to the three functions which are given at the bottom. And here it is shown how this method with the variable delay is efficient. On the left, we have the first graph, a small area where we can obtain stability when the time delay is constant. But if the time delay is variable and its strength is increased, the area for which for the area of the parameter space for which stability is achieved becomes larger and larger, and this is verified again at the bottom. Well, this is the final from this initial part, not related to the Olympiads. Almost 20 years ago, for the first time, we started by collecting most samples from the territory of the country. This has been done already in many other countries for a few decades. The most samples has to be collected in a proper way. There are many species, perhaps around 2,000. In the university in Skopje, there was a lady which is specialist in the moss studies, so she helped to select one particular type of mosses, Hypnum cupressiforme, or simply Hypnum. So we collected samples from about 80 sites on the territory and examined these samples by two techniques, by atomic absorption spectroscopy and also by neutron activations. This second part was done in Dubna, a nuclear center near Moscow. And this is the concentration of zinc presence in moss samples. Moss is particularly interesting for such studies because it doesn't have a proper root system. So it obtains most of the ingredients for its development from the air. So collecting such samples, you could see what is the state of the air pollution in the area. Well, about the Olympiads, a few pictures from the Olympiad in Isfahan. To the right, at the top, it is the university hall, a big theater hall where the ceremony of opening and closing was done. It was about 20 kilometers outside of the city. In the outskirts of the city, the environment looks like what is shown on the left. Well, the hotel and two memorable constructions. One is the central square in Isfahan on the left. It is enormous. It is in length more than 500 meters and more than 200 wide. In the past, there people used to play polo in 16th-17th century. And at the bottom, there is a big bridge on the river with many shops on the bridge. Well, on a visit, the students, participants at the Olympiad could see robot playing on piano. Well, there I did some survey among the students. About 150 students responded, and one of the questions was, what was the main inspiration for their interest into physics? And the majority responded, it is teachers. So for young people like you, this could be also some inspiring profession to teach younger generations in a field which you like. Well, there were some other questions, what they are their intentions to do in the future. Most responded that they want to study physics, that this is an interesting profession, that they would like to do investigations, scientific work, to study physics phenomena, and about the conditions in their country, there were various answers. In some they are good, in some not. Well, here there are some data about the success of various countries at the Olympiads. Well, normally at the Olympiads there is only individual ranking. There is no ranking, as in the mathematics Olympiads, of the ranking of countries. But here, well, what is presented is the number of medals that achieved in various regions of the world. So in Asia, China has best results. Of 60 possible outcomes, they have 59 gold medals and one silver. In former Soviet Union, Russia has most gold medals, again 60 awards. In North America, United States has most golden awards. In Eastern Europe, Romania is the first with 20 medals. In Western Europe, it is Germany, 10 medals. In South America, Brazil. In Australia, well, in comparing only with New Zealand, which actually participates very rarely. And Egypt hasn't got so far any gold medal, but Egypt and other African countries started to participate only recently. And below, there are there is a list of some Asian countries which have also considerable number of awards. For example, Singapore, which is a country of about 5 million people, they have more gold medals than Romania and Germany together, and other countries. Well, this is a comparison of the average results from various regions. Well, there is at the left comparison between the world average and results of average Asian countries, average of the Asian countries. How it is calculated, the average? Well, the number of students from each country is taken, and each who has received gold medal obtains 5 points, for silver 4, for bronze 3, for honorable mention 2 points, and for participation 1 point. And this is done for all Asian countries and divided by the number of students that have participated. And you see that Asian countries always, practically always, there is exception at the beginning, have a better result than the average of the world result. Here, data are taken for a little over 8,000 participants over the years. To the right-hand side, in the first line, countries from the former Soviet Union, with the exception of the Baltic countries. So at the beginning, we have much better result for the Soviet countries, but actually this is only Russia at the time when the Soviet Union was not was still existing. Then later on, well, there are fluctuations, and actually some tendency for the average result of former Soviet countries to be lower than the average for the world. At the bottom to the left, comparison between Eastern European countries and the world average. Eastern European countries are starting from, let's say, to the west, Slovenia, Czech Republic, Poland, then going to the Baltic Republics, Romania, Slovakia, and to the south, Yugoslav Republics, Romania, and Bulgaria. Well, here at the beginning, Eastern countries have better results than the average. Then there is a period of about 10 years when the results are better for the world average. And then in the last 10 years, again, Eastern Europe excels in comparison with the world average. And then on the right-hand side, Western Europe, so what remains from Europe without the countries mentioned before, including United States and Australia, which actually improved the results of Western Europe. We see that all the time Western Europe has lower results from the in comparison with the world average, which is perhaps unexpected, but there are no errors in these numbers. And here, South America and the world comparison, the results are lower for the countries of South America. They started to participate also comparatively recently, and their results are getting better over years. Here, some data about the research from various countries in the world. Well, here the EU countries are selected. First 13 with best performance. 13 is selected because in the Balkans there are 13 countries. So the data are obtained from a site of Madrid University, and in the field of physics and astronomy, in the period of 22 years, the whole number of publications from Germany ranks it at the fourth place, and so on. Ranking for the 2017 is third place, so there is some improvement. If there is improvement, the color is given in red. So improvement shows also Czech Republic. Spain remains at the same place. The others go a little bit downward. In the third or fourth and fifth columns, the same kind of data, but only considering the field of condensed matter, which is a field which has most publications in comparison with others. The whole field of physics and astronomy is divided into 10 subfields. And if we consider what are the shifts for all these subjects, for example, for Germany, in condensed matter field, there is no shift. It is fourth for the whole interval of more than 20 years, and it is fourth again. But considering other nine fields, there is shift downward by five positions. And also for other countries. Some have shifted more than others. For example, Netherlands has lost 31 position, Finland even 39. Czech Republic has improved by 22 places upward. Here the same data for the world, the best 13 countries. So there is a change in the ranking in the whole field of physics for the whole interval of 96 to 2017. USA was at the first place by the number of publications. Now it is China, and there are also some other shifts. It is remarkable how much Iran has advanced. You could see at the bottom. And this is a similar ranking for European countries. Most of the upward movement is by Turkey. And, well, most of the other countries have moved a little bit downward. Well, how much papers are in physics are published within each country? In Moldova, about 40% of the publications are in physics, or have been. Well, physics had a dominant position, but it is declining, with the exception of Turkey. Here, well, something positive about the cooperation among Balkan countries. For a period of 5 years, in four intervals, the number of joint publications by countries from the Balkan Peninsula. In the last period, for the years 2011-2015, you see the network is much more wide, and the highest number of joint publication is between Turkey and Romania. They have, in this 5 years period, 200 papers with authors from each of the country. Well, this is the contribution in the fields of physics and chemistry of Balkan countries within the world, all Balkan countries together. Well, it is less than 4% now. Now physics has more contributed papers than in the field of chemistry. Well, some conclusions, perhaps you could draw them yourself. Well, and a picture to remind us of the world. This is a picture from South Africa, the state of Lesotho, at the height of about 3,000 meters. Well, thank you for your attention. Well, if there are any questions, if I can, I could be glad to answer. Okay, thank you. Kako da...